Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name's Nigel Robinson. I'm the CEO of Central Asia Metals PLC, or CAML, as we're affectionately known. I'll counter through these slides. There are 32 of them, and I've only got 20 minutes, so apologies, and we can always ask questions anyway. Standard eyesight test. I'm sure all of you can see that. Our standard disclaimer. Company overview. We operate in Kazakhstan, and you can see where it is there. Central Asian region, hence the name Central Asia Metals. And on the back of the success at Kazakhstan, where we produce cathode copper at very low costs, we bought the North Macedonian underground zinc and lead mine called Sasa. We paid $402.5 million 5 years ago to acquire that mine in the late 2017. Very different operation. Underground, as I say, it's got a life of mine out to 2039. Kounrad's got a life of mine out to 2034, so fairly long life assets. And at Sasa, we produce zinc and lead in a concentrate form. More about that later. Just some highlights, just to re-emphasise those numbers. We generated revenue, and these are hot off the press, effectively. We announced these yesterday morning. Revenue of $232.2 million, creating what's known as an EBITDA. I'm sure most of you in the room know what that is. Earnings before interest, tax, depreciation and amortisation of $131.6 million. That's a margin of 57%, which in the mining game is a very good margin, I have to say. And a key number for us, and I'll touch on it later, is free cash flow. How much cash are we generating from those operations? Just south of $90 million. And that drives the dividend we pay. We pay back to shareholders between 30% and 50% of that free cash flow number every year, and I'll touch on the dividend later. But we announced yesterday morning a final dividend for the full year of 10 pence, making 20 pence for last year because we paid an interim in September. As already mentioned, we do have a strong cash balance. We've got a very strong balance sheet. We're debt-free. We took on $187 million of debt when we acquired Sasa. We paid all that off last August. So we're debt-free, cash in the bank, good financial performance. Another key number we like to talk about is health and safety on site. Vitally important in the mining industry. And we had a good number last year. LTIFR stands for Lost Time Incident Frequency Rate. When you lose somebody from site in terms of not, hopefully, God forbid, a fatality. And we've never had a fatality, but from serious injury or something like that, so they can't work the next day. And it's classed as a lost time incident. We had a frequency. That's per million man hours of 0.83. So we only had two incidents the whole year on our mine at Sasa, so something we're quite proud of, and we set a target of 1.69. Purpose-driven approach, I put this up just to say what we do. Our purpose really is to produce base metals that are essential for modern-day living. Most people know that, but that's what we do in a profitable, safe, and a sustainable environment. Very important to us that we do it in that kind of environment. And that drives our strategy. We're focused on sustainability issues at the site, and I'll touch more on those later. Focused on low-cost operations. We can't determine what the price of the metals is. That's determined by the market, and we're a small player. So low cost is important to us to keep the high margins and keep secure in terms of profitability. And the money we make from it, making sure that we invest that wisely, give it back to shareholders on dividends, pay the debt down, put back into the business and try and grow the business. And that's our long-term objective. We had Kounrad, we acquired Sasa, we're now on the hunt for another opportunity to take us to the next level. A little bit more detail on the finance details and any difficult questions. I have my CFO here, Gavin Farrar, with me, and he can answer them on my behalf because I don't know as I'm capable of doing it. But just a quick counter through these. What we suffered last year was, in terms of the metals that we produce, copper had a slight decline. We got an average price received of $8,625 per tonne. It's still a very good price for copper, I have to say. And copper is a real bellwether metal in terms of the economy. And lead as well, that was also down 4%. So we generated, the average price received was $2,113 per tonne. But zinc prices stayed elevated because there's a lot of electricity concerns in Europe. Some of the smelters closed down. So therefore, the actual supply of refined metal into the market was quite constrained, keeping the price high at $3,358 per tonne. So pretty good prices. That drove a kind of a reduction slightly in our revenue, but nothing too much to shout about. But we did suffer, as a lot of businesses, and everybody in this room will know that, suffered from the effects of inflation last year. And in Europe, it was quite severe in terms of electricity. What this chart shows here is that we had a fixed price contract through to the 30th of June last year, and then we couldn't establish a fixed price contract because the prices were so volatile. So we went from 10 cents per kilowatt hour to 40, 45 cents per kilowatt hour in the blink of an eye. And we averaged 36 cents per kilowatt hour in the second half of the year. So a far harder second half to the year for us in terms of our costs. Just a few statistics on the, as I say, hot off the press income statement. I've already mentioned the revenue number. Pretty proud about that. Cost of sales, even though the inflationary headwinds and everything, we managed to keep it just to an 8% increase on cost of sales. And that electricity impact was around about $5 million in the second half alone. So taking that out, you can see actually the control over costs on site wasn't too bad, really. An FX gain. We did suffer an impairment charge, and I'll touch on that in a minute in terms of what drove that impairment charge between the carrying value of the assets in the balance sheet to the discounted cash flows we look at for the particular site. It was actually all born out of SASA and the cash flows for SASA. Admin expenses, we have offices here in London, and we manage the sites from here in London. We have technical staff, etc., but mainly most of the staff are employed overseas in Kazakhstan and North Macedonia. Finance costs reducing, 2.1 from 3.9 because we paid all the debt off in August. And then you can see that looks like a significant drop in profits before tax, but it's because of this impairment charge, basically. If you add that back in on an earnings per share basis, you get similar earnings, in fact, a slight increase in earnings per share. So a pretty good performance. Segmentally, Kounrad, gross revenue, $123.7 million, about 14,250 tonnes of copper cathode, and an EBITDA margin of $95 million. That's a margin of 77% at site. It's a very low-cost operation and highly profitable. SASA, not quite so profitable, 52% margin, but still generating good revenues, and zinc price, as I say, was elevated last year, and an EBITDA of $56.4 million. Just a quick waterfall chart showing how the EBITDA varied from year to year. We did have better EBITDA the previous year. Metal prices were a lot higher, and we didn't have this cost inflation that we suffered from a little bit in last year. But this just shows the various drops in revenue of the metals and the increase in cost base at the sites, etc., etc., and getting down to a $131.6 million number for this particular year. See, on copper cash costs, this is an industry measure in terms of how much does it cost on a unit basis to produce your copper, and they do it for zinc and other metals. But in copper terms, we're a very low cost producer, and you can see that by the number here. And the mining industry is terrible for mixing currencies. So 65 cents per pound, and I've just been talking about dollars per ton for selling price, you have to quickly try and calculate that. That is around about $1,400 per ton. So if you're producing it at $1,400 per tonne and selling it at $8,500 per tonne, you can see you're making a good margin every tonne of copper that you produce, and we do about 14,000 tonnes of it per annum. Commentary there in terms of where the increases were, but really there's no one particular element of our cost base at Kazakhstan that is exposed if it increased significantly. You can see payroll increased quite significantly year on year. We had to pay the staff a little bit more. There's a bit of issues in Kazakhstan. Some of you may have been aware of that last year. And we did a benchmarking exercise to make sure we stayed competitive in the area with our staff. Power costs, very low power costs in Kazakhstan. It is a coal-fired economy, effectively, and we pay 4.5 cents per kilowatt hour for electricity. I've just mentioned going to 45 cents per kilowatt hour in North Macedonia, so you can see the difference there. And then we've got reagents that we use in the plant, processing. Realisation is how you get it out to the market. We use an off-taker called Traxys, and they deliver the copper to the market for us. G&A costs, and then the Kounrad C1 cash cost. Margin, 77%. Similar kind of analysis here for SASA. Slightly different, I have to say, the way we analyse it. Run of mine is how much ore we actually mine in the underground mine. And then the mining cost, the processing cost, local G&A cost, giving you a site-based operating cost to give you what we class as the run of mine cost, which increased over the year about $11 per tonne. And we have $55.6 per tonne. CapEx, important mining businesses are quite capital intensive, as you can imagine. We spent last year $17.4 million, up from 2021, which was $14.8 million. We've got a couple of key projects that we're dealing with at SASA, and that was the lion's share of it, sorry. SASA sustaining CapEx, all mines have sustaining capital, replenishing the equipment, underground development, whatever it may be, flotation equipment, you get that annually. And we generally spend about $8 to $10 million at SASA and about $2 million at Kounrad on sustaining basis. So we incurred $7.7 million SASA last year, $2.5 million at Kounrad, and the cut and fill project, which I'll talk about later, was $7.2 million. In fact, it was about $11.9 with some prepayments we made towards the end of the year that hadn't been capitalised on the balance sheet but were classed as receivables. Balance sheet, strong balance sheet. I mentioned that before. We've got $60 million of cash in the bank. We have no debt now at all. The one grey mark on this, or the one negative impact we've got here, is this impairment that I mentioned before. So the auditors, we use auditors obviously to audit our accounts. We've had PwC, we've now got BDO, and they came and looked at the carrying value and do their analysis of the cash flows from the Sasa mine. And as a consequence of a number of factors, as a snapshot at the end of December, one, using a fairly high discount rate, because we have no debt now and the cost of equity is classed as higher, one, using fairly weak consensus commodity prices. You may be as bullish as you want to be about copper, but you have to use some kind of consensus that the bank's given. They're generally quite prudent on those. Adding in the cost inflationary pressures we were incurring at that time, all came up into a kind of combination, together with some studies, which I'll touch on later, which has changed our views on what the output is, what output we're capable of at Sasa into the future, with some drilling we've done to understand the ore body a little bit better. Led to a $55 million reduction in the PPE, and that went through the P&L as you saw before. It's a non-cash item, it's a bit of a technical adjustment, didn't affect the actual financial performance from a cash performance basis of the business, but it's something which we accepted and we move on with a reduced level of PPE. Cash flow, waterfall chart again, showing the amount of cash we had at the beginning of the year down to fairly similar amounts actually. But in generating all that cash flow from the operations, we paid dividends of 48 million. We paid off all the borrowings, another 23.8 into August. And then we repaid some overdrafts we had. And then we paid tax in both Macedonia and Kazakhstan. And then CapEx, $17.4 million. So good use of capital, still maintaining a pretty healthy cash balance. Free cash flow, as I've already mentioned, $90 million. So good financial performance, some numbers we're really proud of, and I think as in potential investors, you can see that it is a strong, profitable business. Sustainability is a key focus for us. It is in the mining industry throughout. All the big mining companies are really focused on sustainability. Let's be honest, mining has not got the best name in the world for how it's been historically, but a lot of mining companies are cleaning their act up, and we like to feel that we're part of that, and I think we do a really good job for the size of company we are. I won't go through these slides in too much detail because I'm a bit conscious of the time, but this double materiality approach is where we go back to our stakeholders and ask them what's important to you as to what our business, Sasa and Kounrad and CAML in general, do. And out of that process, we've defined five pillars of sustainability that we focus on significantly. And these are the material areas. There's lots of other areas, but you've got to focus on the material areas, which are maintaining health and safety, focusing on our people, making sure that they're trained properly, that we take on the right people, we look after those people. Caring for the environment, a key thing in the mining industry, water management, waste management, how you deal with your tailings. Value for the community. Most mining businesses are in areas that, you know, it's a pretty deprived community half the time. So you've got to work with the local community, not just for the people that are employed in the mine, but also how you look after things that are important to them in that community. And lastly, but certainly by no means least, delivering value through stewardship. That's vitally important in the mining industry as well, governance. If you haven't got a license to operate, you haven't compliance with the mining requirements in that country, then you're on a bit of a sticky wicket. So we've paid a lot of attention to the governance aspects of the business. And the next few slides really go through each one of those pillars, really. And as I say, I'll just go through them. Delivering value through stewardship. We put quite a lot of emphasis there on training the staff so they all know about anti-bribery laws, so there's no corruption in the business, that we know about human rights, etc., and we make sure that the staff are trained and aware of those things, especially the frontline staff who deal with suppliers, for example. Health and safety. I've touched on health and safety. I mentioned before that we had a target to beat the 2021 target. The 2021 number was 1.69. We had four incidents at Sasa in 2021. Last year we had two, so it was an improvement. But I have to say, health and safety, you can never sit back on your laurels and say, we're okay now, we can perform like that. You're always conscious of the next incident is just around the corner. So training the staff, making sure they're aware of dangers on site and they're aware of their own personal accountability for safety is vitally important in what we do. Focusing on our people, again, we've got 1,100 people now that we employ, so a lot of them overseas. We make sure that they get properly trained. We've got a big focus on diversity and inclusivity. There is, especially on gender diversity in the mining industry, there's you know, certain areas of mining where you get very few women at all. And there's no reason why those women can't be employed in those areas, and we're trying to make a focus to try and recruit them, train them, and develop them in those areas. Other areas, it's fine. Laboratory works and G&A tend to be no problem with diversity, but on the technical areas, there is a bit of an issue, and we're working hard to try and get more females into the business. Climate change, we're proud of this actually. We set ourselves a target that by 2050, 2030, we'd have a 50% reduction in our greenhouse gas emissions. We measured them from a base of 2020 at around about 100,000 tonnes of CO2 equivalents. We managed to negotiate in North Macedonia 100% renewable electricity, because there's lots of hydroelectric power in Macedonia. And that's enabled us over the years that we negotiated it, over the past 18 months that we've had that contract in place, to make significant inroads. And last year, the year just gone, 2022, that's the level we reported, about 59,000 tonnes, so about a 40% reduction in our greenhouse gas emissions. We've also got, and I'll touch on it later, a project in Kunrad to build a solar farm, which will probably add another 6% reduction in that. And then we've got the challenge to get to this target through electric vehicles, various things we're looking at in terms of efficiencies on site with power, et cetera, to hit that target by 2030, and that's the plan. Caring for the environment, again, as I said before, major focus in mining. We have some long-term targets here and we have some short-term targets. In particular, the long-term targets are driven by the cut and fill project at Sasa. I've already mentioned the 50% reduction in group greenhouse gases, but a couple of other ones that are quite important. 75%, that's quite a big reduction in water abstraction in the area. And that will be by recycling water through the plant and the process plant and by what we're doing with the cut and fill project. And then tailings. Tailings is the process waste management. So if process waste, sorry, the management of process waste on the site. So if you, as I said before, 800,000 tonnes gets brought to the surface, crushed and milled, it's probably only about 80,000 tonnes of that goes through as concentrate with metal in it that goes to the smelters to be produced. So nearly 90% of what you mine becomes waste. And you have to deal with that waste on site, and it's vitally important how you deal with that. So we have a project to move to more environmentally friendly ways of doing it. Traditionally, people put it onto wet dams. We're now going to have a combination of wet dams, putting it back into the voids that you've mined, the holes that you've basically been mining, and then put it back as kind of paste, like a toothpaste that goes in there and sets solidly, and also dry stack tailings, which is squeezing a lot of the moisture out of it and putting it on the surface in an engineered form. There's a thing called GISTM, which is important to mention as well, which we say we'll be compliant with by 2024. This came about from some disasters of tailings dams you may have read about in Brazil, where many people were killed actually with the failure of a tailings dam. And so the whole mining industry has got together to dictate what are the best standards of managing tailings, and we're making sure that we comply with that industry standard. Last but by no means least of these five pillars is looking unlocking value for the communities. We put a lot of time and effort into this, and just to emphasise, we put money each year from our revenue, and it was 0.25% into what we've created, which is a local charity. That money is then spent on good causes locally. We've just agreed to increase that to 0.5%. Around about $1 million a year will be going into those two foundations, one at Sasa, one at Kunrad, to do various projects which we feel are useful that the local mayor, we liaise with the local mayors or the local community to see what they want. And the other thing on the communities is local employment, really. Kunrad, 100% local employment. We don't have lots of expats on site. It's 100% local employment. And at Sasa, we only have about 12 people helping us with this transition project to have 98% local employment. So really good numbers for a mining business in terms of local people being employed. So what do we do? Quite quickly, Kunrad, that's not the best picture in this particular mode, I have to say. It's an aerial shot of the mine. That's a huge open pit mine, 500 metres deep, 1.8 kilometres north to south and about 1.8 kilometres east to west. Probably change those numbers every time I talk about it. It might be 1.5, 1.6, who cares? But it's big. And these are the dumps on the side, eastern dumps. So it's basically ore that they mined in this open pit and could never process because the technology wasn't available. Going back to 1936, 1937. It's a smelter down here in a town called Balkhash, and all the other ore was actually gone through a traditional flotation process. So this was effectively waste, 650 million tonnes of waste. And what we do is we irrigate it, as we call it, which is putting highly diluted sulfuric acid onto it. It picks up little bits of copper on it. We put it into collector trenches and put it down here to an SXEW plant. That stands for solvent extraction electrowinning. It's traditional, it's used in the copper industry. Probably 30% of the world's copper is done through electrolysis in SXEW type plants. So it's not our technology as such, but we've used it and we were the first to use it in Kazakhstan. That's got a nominal capacity of 15,000 tonnes per annum, and we leach the areas, produce the copper, and we now believe we've got about 112,000 tonnes of copper recoverable in these dumps, having operated there now for nearly 11 years. Just a few statistics on it. You can see our production has been fairly stable since 2016 at around about 13,000 to 14,000 tonnes. Eastern dumps are very different from the western dumps in terms of the metallurgy, but we've planned all that in terms of recovery rates. We've got up to 50% on the east and up to 42% on the west. And we've been, as I say, consistently producing at that kind of level for the past 5 to 6 years. Solar power plant, I mentioned that before, it's quite small by international standards, it's only 5 megawatts, but there are restrictions in Kazakhstan. It feeds directly into the plant. If you go above that, you have to go into the kind of national grid that we would have, and it's quite bureaucratic. So this is a starter pack for us, and it will contribute about 16 to 18% of our electrical power requirements. So not enough, but it's not been driven, this project, by economic requirements, because it's very low power costs anyway. It's more for us to do our, you know, our green credentials effectively in Kazakhstan, and that's probably the only thing we can actually do to make inroads into that and make ourselves environmentally friendly in that area.
You've got 30 seconds.
30 seconds. Looking back over 10 years at Kunrad, so I won't even bother about that. We had some success at Kunrad. Sasa, this is a very different mine. Underground lead and zinc mine, as I said before. And what we do is traditional mining there. Some numbers there, as you can see. Zinc, 21,500 tonnes last year, 27,300 of lead. Guidance, similar this year, slightly down because we are finding as we go lower, and it's quite a bit of work we've done on drilling, the grades are declining a little bit and the ore body is narrowing and pinching and swelling. So we've got to, had to refine the mining method. And the project I've been talking about all the time is three areas. A new central decline, a bigger tunnel effectively to make access into the ore body easier, ventilation easier. That's going to be 4 kilometres long in total when it's finished. It'll finish in 2024. We've done about 1.5 kilometres and we hope to hole through in May. Fingers crossed. If we don't, there's going to be some shit flying. But basically, that's what we hope to do. And paste backfill plant, which is the key part of the actual equipment that we're putting on site. This is the plant that will mix the tailings with concrete and fly ash and then put it back underground to manage our tailings more effectively. That's making great progress and that will be commissioned next month and into wet commissioning in May and June and to be online for the second half of this year for cut and fill mining. And then the last part of it is the dry stack tailings plant, which we'll start construction of in the second half of this year, and the landform to manage the cake, as it's called, which is the tailings, which have been, the moisture has been squeezed out of it and you put on the surface in an engineered form. I will very quickly mention this, the reserves and resources. We've done a lot of work on this from drilling. We've refined and updated our reserves and resources. We've got a very robust mining plan with modern software now, and we're quite confident that is a robust plan leading out to the future. And it's extended the life of mine out to 2039. But the negative side is it's reduced the actual output. So where we're at 800,000 tonnes per annum now, we're looking at getting to 830,000 tonnes. But we have potentially got some upside here. We're only mining in this ore body at the moment, and we're doing some drilling here and here, two ore bodies that have historically been mined. We're going to drill them out this year and find out what the resources and reserves are. Then if we can feed that into the mining plan, then we'll be off to the races and we'll try and factor that in. And it might give either an extension of life or a greater level of output. I'll quickly finish off, because this is important. Please let me just finish on this.
Why have you left the best to last?
Well, because that's the way they put the slides together. return to shareholders, really important. We've been paying dividends since 2012. We've now paid $300 million back, £1.52 in total. And each year, and our policy, as I said before, is 30 to 50% of our free cash flow. The dividend just announced was 47% of that free cash flow. So we use it paying money back to shareholders, paying off the debt, investing back in the business, and the big challenge is finding that next opportunity. And that is, trust me, that is a challenge, because you can't just open another branch in Manchester or Glasgow. I say this all the time. Nobody laughs at it, but I think it's quite funny. But you can't, because you have to go with the geology.
Nigel, you are being selfish with your time.
Right, end of story. Thank you.
There you go. Okay, selfish with your time, however, not selfish with the dividends. So since you listed in 2010, that's quite a significant redistribution, $299 US million. Tantalizingly, you started and you ended your presentation talking about the next big opportunity, the hunt for it. So my stats are 40 opportunities evaluated, 17 NDAs signed, two site visits. Okay, I'm wondering whether the two site visits, if you're able to tell us about the location of those two site visits.
Sadly, I can't, because as most of you know, it's quite confidential when you're going through that process to get to a certain point in any transaction. There's a point at which you break cover and let people know. So,
are you location agnostic, though?
No, we aren't, to be honest with you. And we have refined that over the past couple of years, really, to actually be European time zones. So we are primarily looking in Europe. We're comfortable with Kazakhstan, we'll look there, but probably more earlier stage exploration, and some of the African countries. Not all of them. I think there's 52 countries in Africa, so we won't go to all of them. Some are a bit more problematical. Some of the safest, more sensible countries we go to in that time zone in Africa. We never really go to the Far East, and in terms of going to LATAM, Chile and Peru, which are big copper-producing nations, but there are some political problems there and royalty problems and things, which we're more comfortable sticking with where we are at the moment in Europe, Africa and Kazakhstan.
Okay, powers of deduction there, working over time. Okay, here we go. Hold it right.
It's a bit of an off-the-wall question. Yeah. What about tin mining? Have you looked at tin mining?
We have, actually. Yeah, I'm looking across at Louise and Gavin there. But yes, we have looked at tin mining a little bit.
It's quite a profitable metal, isn't it?
Pardon?
It's quite a profitable metal.
Well, as with all metals, you know, the volatility of the price can really come back and bite you, to be honest with you. And I know tin's been up at very high levels, but it can and it's also come down to very low levels. So how is it mined?
Is it underground? Or
I don't know all the details technically, but it'd be similar to a lot of the other base metals. It'd be underground mining or open pit mine. Depends on the actual operation, to be honest with you. Yeah.
What's your outlook for copper?
Very bullish on copper. I think this year there's a kind of balanced market. And what I mean by that is supply and demand is probably balanced in terms of, you know, supply disruption, which you read about in Panama and Chile and Peru and things like that. But the demand is coming back. China's coming back with demand. Europe's not quite as bad as we thought, maybe. So it started off fairly bleak on copper. I think this year is going to be okay for copper. And we're now at the moment around about $8,500 per ton, which is for us is a good price as a low-cost operator. Further down the track, though, it gets even rosier, I think, for copper. You read any statistics and the demand and supply mismatch is becoming bigger and bigger because it's getting harder and harder to find copper. And the jurisdictions you have to go to are harder, the head grades are lower, the capital intensity required is more, you know, a bigger level of intensity. And boards at the moment are nervous, therefore they're not making those investments. And there's a long gestation period between making the decision to invest and actually coming on stream to produce copper. So that's getting harder, and yet the demand, regardless of who you listen to, for EV and electrification is becoming significant, and it will only continue that way. So I think the story is very bullish.
And the story to me is becoming quite collegiate in terms of the way that you're wanting to get more girls technically astute. So I'm just wondering if you will soon be sponsoring your own technical college or perhaps a university if you haven't done so already.
We do look into those things and we're keen to do that, yes. So, I mean, the mining in the UK has not got a very good track record over the recent years in terms of the number of courses offered and Camborne University and the issues with that. So, yeah, we're keen to sponsor students of both genders, to be honest with you. But we do help with women in mining. We're quite active in that. We have myself included and Gavin, and, you know, we do mentor women in mining and help try and develop people. But, yeah, so we're quite keen to do that. And it's definitely the technical areas. And as mining becomes more automated and more innovation in mining, you might find it more attractive to women than maybe the view of mining, which is you go down this dark hole and it's quite an arduous task with a pick and shovel, which maybe the view that some people have. So yeah, we're keen to sponsor where we can and help where we can and, you know, contribute where we can.
So the pick and shovel is a real sort of grunt work. The blue sky is the hunt for that next opportunity. But let's go back to the grunt work. What are you, is the board intending to do over the next 6 months to continue and develop this growth and the coffers? How are you going to spend that money?
Well, that's a nice problem to have for a start-off. We will maintain our dividend policy, so we will be giving money back. That's absolute paramount to us. And the cash balances will probably grow, hopefully will grow. But we are looking for opportunities. And some of the earlier stage opportunities we would finance out of the balance sheet. They might be $5, $10 million. We would invest off our own cash reserves to do that. The bigger, more transformational transaction, like another SASA, for example, we'd have to go to the equity markets and debt markets. We got good banking relationships, so we got good debt capacity. So we could finance those out of equity and debt, but the early stage ones will finance off the balance sheet. And if we don't find them and don't find something suitable to invest in, the reserves will grow and there'll come a point where, you know, the management team will have to look and say, what do we do with this cash? Do we give it back as a special dividend? Do we give it back in a buyback? And we'll make that decision at the time. But at the moment, we're comfortable giving the money back and building the cash balances and being, you know, in a safe position like that. But we are keen to grow the business effectively.
Very good. Thank you very much. It's been an absolute pleasure.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks for allowing me to tease you.
No worries. Thanks.
Thank you.